Carey. Welcome to After the News. We're talking about Ebola. Joining me are Dr. Catherine Troisi, PhD and Associate Professor at the UT Health School of Public Health. Also, Dr. Brian Arenar, Director of Disease Control and Clinical Prevention at the Harris County Public Health Department. We want to welcome both of you to After the Newscast. Now, first of all, we last talked about airborne. That's the question I'm getting from a lot of people. They simply don't believe that this is just through bodily fluids and blood contact. How do you convince the viewers out there and those who are watching us on the stream that this is airborne?
That it's not airborne.
That it's not airborne, exactly.
I think that you have to look at the epidemiology. For example, influenza is a virus that is airborne, and you can just be in the same room with somebody, you can, and get the disease. We don't see that happening with Ebola. There's absolutely no evidence that it is airborne.
All right, Dr. Arenar.
So it's very important to make a distinction between airborne, as we think of it, breathing the same air of a person next to you, breathing the air in the room, which can happen with other more common viruses, and aerosolized. That's the distinction. The Ebola virus survives and persists when it's in bodily fluid. Bodily fluid can, with certain medical procedures, those in intensive care, those in critical care settings, potentially become aerosolized. That's a droplet that is temporarily airborne. So that's not in the air.
Okay.
But the talk about airborne has led people to falsely come to the unscientific realization that it could be in the air or the water or the food, none of which is the case.
Now, do you understand the public's position on this? So you're a highly educated medical professional, and we're just getting information off of the internet and what we can piece together in order to try and protect ourselves and our family.
Of course. We recognize that while Ebola is not new to science and medicine, it's new to the people in our community. And the ideas about it and the modes of its transmission have been open to some speculation. So we want to dial that back a bit and look at what is the science, what do we really know about the disease. We've got 40 years of experience with that, and we have not seen any evidence of true airborne transmission of Ebola.
Dr. Troisi, what went wrong with the 40 years of experience when it came to Dallas? We're seeing some very simple mistakes that they admitted occurred there, and as a result, we have some people infected.
Right, well, the 40 years of experience were not in the United States, they were in Africa. And we have not been used to dealing with Ebola in the United States. And it's a tragedy that those mistakes happened, but it shows that we need to be on our guard all the time, that we need to do training of healthcare personnel, that we need to screen patients maybe a little more carefully. So we are learning from those mistakes.
I received a comment or a question from a healthcare worker who says she's concerned about her health. What do we need to do more of when it comes to those nurses and those aides who are working in the hospital and they come into contact with individuals who may have Ebola?
So there are two things. The first message that we've made sure we've gotten out and worked with some terrific medical institutions in our community, make sure that all medical providers recognize the importance of a travel history. Mm-hmm. This is the means by which we initially identified patients who are at risk. A person who has traveled within the last 21 days from one of the affected countries, Liberia, Sierra Leone, or Guinea, and develops fever greater than a 101.5 and symptoms that could be consistent with Ebola should raise a flag. Anyone who doesn't have that history, has not been in contact with an Ebola patient, is likely to have fever, perhaps travel-related, from some other much more common origin, typically malaria, or any one of a number of travel-related fevers, or other sources of fever. So that's the message for the frontline healthcare worker, where a patient initially might make contact. On the other hand, we have patients who may, in the case of Dallas, be admitted to hospital, and now healthcare workers are called upon to raise the bar and the standard with which personal protective equipment is used to be able to do medicine safely. There are about 18 hospitals that have been identified by the CDC throughout the nation, not in Texas, as being centers of excellence and locations for the ultimate standard of care, but the virus could come to a hospital at any location. We need to be prepared. The thing about the personal protective equipment, or PPE, is that it must be at the utmost standard. There's really no room for error.
Mm-hmm. Dr. Troisi, we have always taken pride at being the medical capital of the world here in Houston, and we're not getting any attention or any facilities are not being designated here in Houston. What happened here?
Well, these designations happened before this current outbreak where they had procedures in place, but I'm sure that many of our hospitals here in the medical center, maybe not community hospitals, could easily accept an Ebola patient and protect both the patient and the healthcare workers.
One of the questions I'm getting from many of the viewers out there and on social media, their concern is why is Thomas Duncan the only one to die in this case? We had healthcare workers who are surviving, we had doctors who are surviving, he is the only one to have died. Tell me, give me a reason why he is the only one who has died at this point and track it back to where you see the mistakes were made either by him or by the hospital.
I just want to say that the fact that he died does not mean a mistake was made, because the virus has a 70% mortality rate, and even with the best medical care, people are going to die from Ebola. Just like with cancer, we have one of the best cancer institutions in the world, but people still die of cancer. So the fact that some people have died does not mean necessarily there was a mistake made.
Dr. Arnor?
You know, that's a tough question without knowing the details of the case, and those are not ones that are in the public domain and not ones that we frankly have explored thoroughly. So I can't comment on the specifics of the individual care. I think that it behooves our medical providers to provide the best possible care. We're dealing with a disease that we are learning how it interfaces with U.S. medical care. Treatments are experimental. ZMapp was available, no longer is as widely available, takes a long time to produce. We're ramping up vaccine development, so I think it continues to evolve.
What's the best advice you could give someone here in Houston to calm them down about the potential of being infected with Ebola?
The cases of Ebola, that Mr. Duncan and the two nurses now have received a lot of media attention. But there have been many, many people who have been exposed who have not become infected. The patient who traveled to Nigeria and developed symptoms on the plane was vomiting on the plane. He had diarrhea. None of those airline passengers, even though they were, you know, in that contained space, became infected. So we are going to see a few cases, but your risk in Houston is, unless you've been to one of those countries, is zero.
Now, we are, as I said earlier in the newscast, an international city. And there are individuals who are constantly flying in from African countries, from England, from all over the world here to Houston. Should that be a concern of ours? And I'll tell you why I bring that point out. I read online a comment made by an African-American woman who says she's going to avoid all people from Africa from that as a result of what's going on with Ebola. What do you do with a situation with a mindset like that?
So everything we know about the science of and the transmission of this disease is that the Ebola infected patient is not capable of transmitting the disease until once symptoms develop. And we know from the natural course of the disease, even sometimes despite the best medical care, that symptoms can worsen very quickly. So a person who is sick, truly sick with Ebola, should raise serious concern. Short of that, we have suspicion and wanton suspicion, and in general, it's overly stated.
Okay. We want to thank you guys for joining us in this frank discussion about Ebola, and we want to thank you guys for submitting your contracts. Your comments, not contracts. That'll wrap it up for After the News. Back to you guys.